Good morning. Welcome. Welcome back to Liberty Baptist Church. We're happy to have you here today. Good number today. People must have thought this was the first service of the new year, and they were starting their New Year's resolution, so we got a good showing today. That's right. Now, we're happy that you're here this morning. We got a couple of announcements that we're going to go over, and then we're going to go into our song service, and then we'll have our sermon at probably the bottom of the hour. But first, let's talk about what we've got going on in the coming weeks here at Liberty Baptist. This morning, we had a good number in Sunday school. We had 121 that were here this morning studying God's Word. We in the Sunday school class that I'm a part of, Matt Goss, started us on a study of the book of Titus this morning, and we're looking forward to seeing what Paul wrote in that book, and we're looking forward to covering that in the next couple of weeks. I encourage you, if you're not connected to a Bible study on Sunday mornings at 10 o'clock, Please see Zandy Knox. He would love to connect you with a Sunday school class, or you can talk to any of your church staff, and we'll be happy to find a class that you would fit with. This coming week, the church office is going to be closed on Tuesday for the New Year's holiday. We will be having Jam, Jesus and Me, on Wednesday night. That starts at 6:45, and this is a ministry that we've been doing this past year of reaching out to children and youth of our community. God has greatly blessed the willingness of people in our church to minister to these children, and we're thankful for that opportunity. So that'll be at 6:45. We'll also be having our Bible study at the 7 o'clock hour here in the main sanctuary. January the 7th, you can go ahead and put on your calendar. It'll be deacons meeting, Baptist women will be meeting. And then the one that everybody likes to know, January the 8th at 12 p.m., is the Tag Luncheon, Touching All Generations. So if you like to eat, that's a good time to come. If you like to fellowship, it's a good time to come. If you like church, it's a good time to come. Really, there's no reason not to be here unless you're working. Yeah, thank you for laughing. I appreciate that. The jokes don't get any better, folks. I'm just going to tell you. Also, Brother Zandy talked last week about, or I believe in 2 weeks ago, about Connect, and we're going to be emphasizing connections with individuals through our Sunday school classes in 2019, and you can read more about that in your bulletin this morning. Finally, year-end contributions to the church. Those for tax purposes have to be received by tomorrow, December the 31st. If you mail the contribution, it has to be postmarked December the 31st. You can find more information about that in your bulletin. Finally, you'll find several thank you notes in your bulletin this morning that you'll want to read that were written to our church body. Finally, an announcement that there will be the men at Liberty Baptist Church will be attending a men's night out. This is going to be on Thursday, February the 28th. This will be at Second Baptist Clinton. The guest speaker is Johnny Hunt. There'll be a meal at 5:15. The main service then begins at 6:30. There's a sign-up sheet in the foyer. So men, if you're interested in going, go ahead and sign up. It's $10 to attend. It's not too bad of a deal. $10, get to have a catfish meal, and get to hear a speaker as well. So we look forward to that time on February the 28th. With that, we want to continue to be in prayer for all of those that are on our prayer list. We want to remember our pastor and his wife as they're away with family, and we just pray extra blessings upon them. With that, I encourage you, if you would, to please pray with me. Let's pray. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this time to come together in your house, and dear Heavenly Father, no matter what 2018 has been to us, whether it has been great and wonderful, or if it really has not been great and has not been wonderful, and in fact has been a trying year for us. Dear Heavenly Father, we just come here today, regardless of the situations that brought us here, we come here this morning just thanking you that you still love us and that you are still our sovereign Lord. Dear Heavenly Father, we come this morning just praising your name, thanking you for all that you have done for us, dear Heavenly Father, in terms of protection and for blessing us. And, dear Heavenly Father, we just pray this morning that we would, individuals, that we would just continue to choose to follow that path that you have in front of us. Dear Lord, we just pray, thanking you for what's going to occur here in this service this morning. We love you. We praise you. For it's in Christ's name we pray, and amen. I encourage the congregation and choir to stand as we sing hymn number 149. 149, praise him, praise him.
Christ is that blessed Christmas morn. Go tell it on the mountain, over the hills and everywhere. Go tell it on the mountain that Jesus Christ is born.
Take a moment, say hello to somebody beside of you. Tell them what you got for Christmas. And I hope that someone greeted you here this morning. As we continue to stand and sing, let's sing hymn number 202, How Great Our Joy.
While by the sheep we watch that night, glad tidings brought an angel bright. How great our joy, great our joy.
Christ the baby. hymn this morning is hymn number 557. 557. Precious. Thank you for allowing us to be in your house this morning. Lord, we ask you bless this meeting, bless our service, bless Pastor Paul and Joellen as they travel, bless these tithes and offerings, Lord, and lead our service as you would have it go. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior, I pray. Amen. Thank you, Kathy, and thank you, choir. We're happy this morning to have Brother Randy Roper with us. He's the Director of Missions for the Big Emory Baptist Association. If you've not heard Brother Randy speak, you're in for a real treat this morning. We're looking forward to what he's going to talk about over the next 4 hours, and I'm sure that at least the first three are going to be great. With that, Brother Randy, we look forward to seeing what God's placed on your heart this morning.
And the jokes don't get any better, do they? Well, good morning. I am so glad to be with you today. You have already made me feel so at home. I feel at home when I'm here with you at Liberty Baptist Church. One of the brothers this morning asked me, he said, did you have any trouble finding our church? And of course, I didn't. I've been here many times. But now last week, I had the opportunity to preach at Elizabeth Baptist Church. Now, I know how to get there now, but the first time when you put it in your GPS and it just says, do the best you can. Now, some of you won't get this, and some of you will. They're so far out. There was a guy walking down the road, and I said, where are you going? He said, I'm going towards town. I said, why? He said, I'm going hunting. They're so far out, you had to go back towards town to hunt. Now, that's out there when you're that far. Well, it is good to be with you today, and I love the Christmas season, and our children and grandchildren all live in South Central Kentucky, and with their schedules, they're pharmacists and doctors and school teachers, and so we scheduled it. We were only able to have our Christmas yesterday up in South Central Kentucky, and we have 5 grandchildren now, age 8 down to 11 months. So if any time during the message I just start talking about my grandchildren, just don't worry about it. Just listen and laugh, okay? But it was so good to be with them and so good to be with you. I love the Christmas season, but we're moving into the new year. And like we all do, we look at this new year as a new beginning. New beginnings in our lives, new beginnings in our families, in our endeavors. Maybe some of you are working in new jobs. But spiritually also, we look at it as a new beginning. And we do make resolutions. We don't keep very many of them. I think the statistic is only about 7% of the resolutions we make, we actually follow through with. But I do want to talk about something today. You said you had 121 in Sunday school. Praise the Lord for that. 121 folks learning God's Word. Now, my daddy was a preacher, and I've been in church all my life. In fact, I've told you, I was in church 9 months before I was ever born. I was in church. I've grown up in church. And in that, I've actually learned a little bit about God's Word. I think I know maybe the basic principles of what God wants in our life. And this morning's message is maybe a little different message for a new year, but is a message I think is dearly needed. And I want you to know that I preached this message to myself on my 35-minute drive up here, and God got all over me about things in my life that I need to take care of that this message is going to talk about today, because today's message is on obedience. On obedience. And I want to put it like this. I want to pose this to you today. Now, I told you I've been in church all of my life. How many of you would consider that you've been in church most of your life or a lot of your life? You've grown up in, oh man, overwhelming. Is there anybody in here that has been in church or been a Christian and been in church less than a year in this church this morning? Less than a year. I don't see any hands going up. Now I want to pose this to you, and then we're going to go on in our message today. What if we never learned anything else in God's Word? What if we never were taught anything else? We never learned anything new in God's Word. But what about this? What if we obeyed the things we already know? What if we just obeyed the things that as of today we already know God's Word says? I think we all would improve. Don't you say amen? When you say amen, I get done quicker. Amen. Let me know you're listening. Not like the guys back there in the sound booth playing cards. Just kidding. Joking with those guys. What if we just obeyed what we already knew? I know I would do a lot. I would be more of what God wanted me to be. And I always want to learn, and we should continue to learn God's Word. But let's not take for granted or not neglect even the basic things that God has told us that we need to obey. And we're going to look at a passage this morning where God speaks to a specific person and he has the opportunity to obey or disobey. I'm going to ask you to take your Bibles and turn to Luke chapter 5 this morning. Luke chapter 5. I'm going to ask you to stand for just a moment in honor of the reading of God's Word. Luke chapter 5, beginning in verse 1. So it was, as the multitude pressed about him, Jesus, to hear the Word of God, that he stood by the lake of Gennesaret. That's just another name for the Sea of Galilee. And he saw two boats standing by the lake, but the fishermen had gone from them and were washing their nets. Then he got into one of the boats, which was Simon. This is Simon Peter. And he asked him to put out a little from the land, to shove out his boat away from the bank a little bit. And he sat down and he taught the multitudes from the boat, Jesus did. And when he had stopped speaking, he said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch. Let's stop right there. Lord, thank you for this day. Thank you for our opportunity to come into your house and learn more about you. But Lord, the object today is not to just gain some knowledge, not to put another notch in our Bible, but to say, Lord, what are you speaking to my heart today? Not my neighbor's heart, not my spouse's heart, not my kid's heart, but what are you saying to me today on the subject of obedience? And Lord, that your Holy Spirit would just ingrain in our hearts and our minds the value of being obedient to your word. Lord, thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. You may be seated. The first thing I want you to see in this, that Jesus has a multitude of people. This was more the beginning of his ministry, but his fame was going around as a great teacher and healer. He was feeding people. And so, of course, people were following him. And there was a great multitude that was following Jesus. And he'd come to this place and he got in Simon Peter's boat. I want you to see, first of all, as we look at this, there's a public message and there's a personal message. There's a public message and a personal message. Now, it said there that he spoke to the multitudes. He got into the boat. He pushed out just a little bit because it helped the sound travel across the water, and he could speak to a lot of people. They didn't have microphones and speakers and all that stuff. And so there was a public message, but I think it's interesting in this passage of Scripture, do you notice that it doesn't say anything that Jesus said to the multitudes? It doesn't tell you what he taught about. And we know that it had to be important for that group of people, and what Jesus said was good and true and right and righteous. But you notice we're not given the context or the content of his message. But then he gets into Peter's boat with him and he pushes out. And so what I want you to hear today is this. There's a public message and we need to hear the public message. That's what we're here today doing, the public message. But more importantly, there's a personal message. And that's what you need to hear today. That's what the Holy Spirit wants to speak truth into your life. And if we're not careful, we will get in a public setting and we'll say, oh, that was a great message and that was great songs and we had a good time today. And we will miss that God wants to speak to each one of us individually. So please today, as this message is preached, and God preached it to me on the way up here from my house this morning, there is something that God, going into this new year, I believe that God wants to speak to you. Don't look over at your spouse or your kids or think about somebody else. Just say, Lord, what do you want to say to me this morning? If you're going to do that, say amen. Thank you so much. So there's a public message. There's a personal message. It's no coincidence that Jesus got in Peter's boat and pushed out that morning. And now we're going to see the personal message. Jesus is going to give Peter a personal message in that boat today. And we get to witness that through God's Word. And so where we left off, he had finished speaking in verse 4, and he had stopped speaking. He said to Simon, launch out into the deep and let down your nets. In other words, they were right around the bank where everybody was, and everybody would fish off the bank just like they do. This morning I came through at Caney Creek Boat Dock. This morning early, there were already all kinds of boats and everything out on the water, and there's people fishing around the dock. But he said, launch out into the deep. Let's do some serious fishing this morning. Let's go out there and throw down your nets for a catch of fish. But look in verse 5 what Peter says. But Simon answered and said to him, Master, we have toiled, we have worked, we have fished all night and caught zilch. Nothing. You see, it was daytime. There were different times on the Sea of Galilee that it was the right time to fish, just like it is around. Sometimes it's better to fish in the morning. Sometimes it's better to fish in the evenings. But they had fished all night long, and they were commercial fishermen. They weren't doing this for pleasure. This was their livelihood. This is how they fed their families. And so Jesus says, okay, Peter, I want you to push out into the deep and launch out your nets for a catch. And Peter looks at Jesus and said, look, we've already fished all night long and we've caught nothing. I imagine it probably sounded more like this. Lord Jesus, I know you. We've fished all night already. We've already fished. We put in our time. And not only that, we haven't caught anything. Now, I like to fish. But it's always a lot more fun when you fish, when you catch some fish. It's not a whole lot of fun when you go out there and you spend all your time and you don't catch anything. It's still fun to go out there, but it's a lot more fun when you're catching fish. But this was their job. It had cost them money, the bait, the time. They'd invested, they'd gone out, and they'd caught nothing. They had gone in the hole financially on that fishing trip. Not only that, it said that Jesus had found these guys washing their nets. They were done. That was a labor-intensive job to wash those nets. They had to do it every time they went out and fished so the nets would not rot. And for them to throw out their nets one time back into the Sea of Galilee, they would have had to gone through that whole process of washing those nets again. And Peter was thinking about all of these things in his mind. And Jesus says, just push out your boat and throw out your nets for a catch. And Peter says, Lord, we fished all night. We've caught nothing. In other words, you know, Lord, we appreciate you. We love you. But maybe, God, you don't get it. Maybe, Jesus, you don't just get it. I thought about this. Give me the liberty here to say this. How many of you men and women do something that you know how to do? You know how to, whether it's cooking or fixing something or building something, and you know how to do it. And somebody comes along that don't know a thing on how to do what you're doing and tries to tell you how to do it. Ain't that a blessing when that happens? I just thought, just go with me here for a minute. Can you imagine Peter, the commercial, professional fisherman, and Jesus, the carpenter? And Peter is thinking, why is a carpenter trying to tell me how to fish? Why don't he go build a chair or something and let me do my job? Peter might have been thinking all of these things. And you know what I came to the conclusion? This is how we are as Christians. My grandson, Rhett, he's almost 3 years old. He's got two older sisters. We were there yesterday at their home. The two girls were up with Meemaw, that's my wife, playing board games. They're older. And it's up a set of steps up into a bonus room that looks out over their living room. And Red is not supposed to be on the steps going up to that bonus room because he's only 3 years old. Guess where Red spent most of his time yesterday? On the steps trying to get to Meemaw. You know, I think how many times we're like that. We're like little baby Christians, and yet we know better. Most of us have admitted we've been in church all of our lives. We know a pretty good amount about God's Word. It's very clear when God speaks what we should do and what we shouldn't do. And yet we become very immature in our Christianity when God tells us to do something and we begin to question it. That's exactly what Peter did. He began to question. He began to make excuses. And Jesus said, just push out your boat and let down your nets. And listen to what he said, for a catch of fish. Now, I can tell you, let's go fishing and let's go catch some fish and we may come back with nothing. But I think you're going to realize in just a minute when Jesus puts that little extra on there, if you will do this, I will do this. Guess what? What he says will come right, come true every time. Do you get that? Say amen. And so what I want you to hear this morning is I may tell you to do something, or Brother Paul may tell you, or Brother Chris, or Brother David, and we may tell you to do something with all the good intentions, and it may or may not come to pass. But let me tell you something. Every time Jesus Christ, and every time we read in God's Word where God says, if you will do this, I will do this, you can take it to the bank, it's going to happen. So why would we argue? Why would we make excuses? Now again, I may tell you to do something that might turn out really bad. I could tell you not intentionally, but I could tell you to do something that might cause you harm in some way. I would never want to do that, but I'm a human. Let me tell you, when God speaks and God asks us to obey Him, let me tell you, it will never cause you any harm. It will be for His glory and your benefit every time. So why do we disobey? Well, I'm glad Peter came to his senses. And so we read there in verse 5 that he said, answered and said, Master, we've toiled all night and caught nothing. And now here's a very wonderful word that follows that. Nevertheless, at your word, I will let down my net. Now, you know what? It still doesn't sound like Peter is real enthused about this. In fact, I think a lot of Peter's thinking at this point, he knows Jesus, he knows who he is. They grew up together. All those guys grew up around Galilee. I believe that Jesus and Peter and a lot of those guys, they knew each other growing up. And Peter knew who Jesus was to a certain extent. And out of respect. But do you hear it in Peter's answer? Nevertheless, Master, I'll let down my net. It was more out of just respect. Let me let you in on something today. Obedience is not just on how you feel. I'm going to tell you, there's a lot of things God wants me to do. Can I be honest with you? I'm just a man, a human and a man and a sinner saved by grace, just like everybody else in this room. But there's a lot of things that God wants me to do. You know what? I'm not real enthused about them when I first hear them because it's against my nature. It causes me to have to sacrifice. Guess what? It causes me to have to forgive people that I may not want to forgive. It causes me to have to love people I may not want to love. And I'm not a lot of times real enthused about everything that God asked me to do. So let me tell you what obedience, it is not based on how you feel. Because it was based on how we feel, we wouldn't do a whole lot of things. Because usually when we're given something to do and we have to obey, usually it's something contrary to what we want in our own lives. And we see that if you hear and read between the lines of what Peter is saying, he is just like you and I. Peter was a fisherman. He was looking with his physical eyes. It's not the right time to fish. We fished all night. We haven't caught anything. We've washed our nets. We're ready to go home and get some sleep. And you're telling us to go out here and do something. But that's not me telling you to do that. This is God Almighty speaking into our lives. But yet I catch myself making the same arguments as Peter. Well, God, I've tried that already. I've tried to make up with that person. Well, go again. Well, I don't know if I've got that to give this week. Well, I didn't ask you if you had it to give. I just said give. Lord, I don't want to go teach that class. Well, I didn't ask you if you wanted to teach that class. I told you to go teach that class. And what I forget is when we obey God, He comes through every time. Folks, listen to me. From experience, God has never let me or my family down when I obeyed His word, and He will never let you down. He will never let your family down when you obey Him. If you believe that this morning, say amen. Because we're about to see what's going to happen here. So Peter says, well, and I'm, again, not very enthused. Well, nevertheless, Lord, Master, at your word, I will let down my net. That's a wonderful word, nevertheless. You know what nevertheless means? Nevertheless means we've heard all of this story. We're walking in a direction. You know, I've worked all night. We had nevertheless, I'm going to turn around and I'm going to do what you want me to do, whether I feel like it or not. Folks, again, get this. If you're going to wait till you feel like obeying God on everything He tells us, you're not going to obey God a whole lot because it's not in our flesh to do that. But when we just say, yes, Lord, when we understand that God is true and just and right and loves you, and whatever He tells you to do is going to be the best for you and your family, when we understand that and can do that and not question Him, and we can look at Him and obey anything He tells us to do, and we know it will be the right thing, even if it doesn't look like the right thing at first, it will be the right thing. Guess what? We're on the road to being a mature Christian. You're on the road to being the right mom and the right dad and the right grandparent and the right son and the right daughter that you need to be, the right worker, the right student. When we read God's word and we don't question and we see that God is true and right and just say, yes, Lord, I'll let down my nets. Nevertheless, Lord, I'll go again and see if I can work that out with that person. Nevertheless, Lord, I don't understand it. I don't think I know enough. But if you've called me to teach a class, I'm going to go teach a class. Nevertheless, Lord, I'm not good with kids, but if you want me to work in the nursery or work in children's church, Lord, that's what I'll do. Nevertheless, because if you're telling me to do it, you've already got it figured out whether I do or not. Amen. That's who God is. And I've seen it. Oh, let me tell you, so many times I've not done it. I could tell you the terrible results of that. Oh, but friends, when you just start dropping those nets, yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Oh, I'm going to tell you, you're going to meet with God. You're going to grow up. You're going to see God and Jesus in a light that you've not seen them before, because He will always come through. First of all, we see His obedience. He went out. He went on out into the deep and He put His nets over the side. At your word, this word, whatever it is, at your word, Lord, I'll obey. Now, I want you to see some things. There was some action that went along with His obedience. And I know a lot of times we say this, well, Lord, I know what you... You know, this happens a lot. We'll say, yes, Lord, I know you're right. I know exactly what you've spoken into my heart. I know what you want me to do. But not just yet. You ever played that game with God? Let me get a few things settled first. Let me just get through this. Let me tell you something about obedience. And man, this sticks me like a dagger. Delayed obedience is disobedience. Uh-oh. Delayed obedience. You see, because most of us know what we're supposed to do. God speaks clearly. Most of us know what the Lord is telling us to do in spiritual matters and matters of this life. Most of us know what is right and what is wrong. Why? Because the Holy Spirit lives inside of you. And most of us already know that in our life, what is right, what is wrong, what God has called you to do. And we make these excuses of why we can't do it right now, but delayed obedience is disobedience. And I've seen that in my life also. And let me just add something. It usually comes with consequences. But now, let me just show you in God's Word how God honors His Word and how He honored Peter in the rest of this Scripture. Look with me. There's some things. Peter was obedient. He pushed out. There was actions involved. He followed through with what he said. Nevertheless, at your word, I'll let down my net. Now look with me in verse 6. And when they had done this, they'd thrown out their net. Listen, they caught a great number of fish and their net was breaking, so that they signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help them, and they came and filled the boat, the boats, so that they began to sink. All right, number one, when you obey God, these four things are going to happen real quickly. They're going to be quick. There's going to be a confirmation. When God speaks to your heart in any matter about His Word or what He wants you to do, and you say yes and you follow through, there will be a confirmation. What did Jesus tell Peter when He said, launch out in the deep? Did He just say, launch out in the deep and drop your nets and we'll see what happens? No, He said, what, did you get that? He said, launch out into the deep, let down your net, listen, for a catch of fish. He'd already told Peter what was going to happen. He said, do this, you're going to catch fish. Peter did it. Guess what? They caught some fish. Anybody surprised by that? I'm not. Every time I've obeyed God like He's called me to do, whatever He said, it came to pass in my life. And listen, this wasn't a regular catch of fish. This was a miraculous catch of fish. They didn't catch fish like this normally on the Sea of Galilee. I mean, they struggled to catch a few fish enough to pay their bills and eat themselves. This was a miraculous catch. There were so many fish in the nets. Their nets were breaking. They had to call their friends over. They began to throw fish into the boat. The boats began to sink. There were so many fish. And we try to disobey God and get a couple of fish when God says, if you'll obey me, I'll give you more fish than you could ever hope for. Are you getting it? There's a confirmation. If you obey God, He will confirm in your life you're on the right track. You're growing. You're becoming more like the person I want you to become. I love you. I'm going to honor you. He will give you a confirmation. Secondly, look with me in verse 8 and 9. When Simon Peter saw it, listen to his reaction. Now think about this. They're out there fishing now and all this action going on and these people around and fish are coming in and the boats are about to sink. And listen, get this. This is weird, Peter's reaction. When Simon Peter saw it, verse 8. He fell down at Jesus' knees saying, depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord. For he and all who were with him were astonished. They were amazed at the catch of fish which they had taken. Folks, listen, this is good. I want you to get this. Because, man, I want to tell you, when I get to this place, it helps me grow. What happened? Peter saw Jesus in a part of His glory. There were times when the disciples at the Mount of Transfiguration at different times, they would see that glory of God come out in Jesus. And it was amazing when these people would see it. They'd never seen this before. And so at this moment, Peter saw that bit of glory of God coming out of Jesus. And let me tell you what happened. Peter saw Jesus for who He really was. Not just a preacher, not just a carpenter, not just the son of Mary and Joseph, not just this guy that grew up down the road in Galilee. Peter saw Jesus for who He really is. And you know what happened? Peter saw himself as who he really was. That's a good thing. It's painful. But it's a good thing. We need to see ourselves as we really are, because most of us have an inflated view of ourselves. Most of us see ourselves, others see us probably differently than we see ourselves. It's a protective mechanism. It's a defense mechanism. But it is very good, church, when we see ourselves for who we really are. That's how we grow. That's how we deal with sin in our life. That's how we get a word from God. And so Peter saw Jesus as He really was, the Son of God glorified. And Peter turned and saw himself. And what did he say? Oh, depart, get away from me. I'm a sinner. Don't you know that Peter grew up a whole lot that day? Don't you know Peter got a lesson that day right at the feet of God Almighty Himself? And so along with the confirmation, there was a conviction in Peter's life. And folks, let me tell you, we've gotten away from that. We don't want to be convicted anymore. We don't want God to tell us no. We don't want God to tell us. We want to tell us that everything we're doing is okay. Folks, everything we're doing is not okay. And sometimes God has to say no. And He reveals Himself in our life. And we see ourselves as we really are. And it helps us to grow up. It helps us to get rid of the sin that's in our life. It helps us to be motivated to do the things we need to do. And if we never come to this point, we will never grow in the glory of Jesus Christ. So there was a confirmation. There was a conviction. Verse 10. And so also were James and John, the sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, "Do not be afraid. From now on you will catch men." I love in the other gospel it says, "You'll become fishers of men." He said, "See this object lesson. You've gone out, you have obeyed me. You've caught all of these fish in a net, so many that the nets were breaking, the boats were sinking." He said, "Come and follow me, and spiritually, I'll do spiritually with people like you're doing with these fish. They'll become born again. You're going to make a difference in the kingdom of God." So the third thing, there's a calling. When you get serious about obeying God, there'll be a confirmation. He'll tell you you're on the right track. There'll be a conviction. That means you're getting your life where it needs to be. And then He'll put the calling on your life. He said, "Come with me. I'll make you fishers of men." And I want to tell you, that calling goes, if you are born again today, it's not just Brother Paul's job. It's not just the deacon's job. It's not just Brother Chris's job. It's not just the leaders of the church. Listen, if you are a born again Christian, this call goes out to every one of us to become fishers of men, women, boys, and girls for the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. Somebody say amen. Every one of us. I loved it when I was a pastor, I would tell my church this all the time. I'm not the only minister in the church. Every one of you that claim to be a born-again Christian, every one of you is a minister in the kingdom of God. And those words are true. Every one of us are called to be fishers of men, women, boys, and girls that need Jesus Christ. And then the last thing, verse 11. So when they had brought their boats to land, they forsook all and followed Jesus. There was a commitment. It started out with a confirmation. He convicted our lives. He called us with a calling. And then He calls us to make a commitment. When they came to, did they still fish to eat? Sure they did. Did they still go fishing? Sure they did. But their priority changed. You see, so many of us think, well, if I'm really going to follow God, I've got to give everything up in my life that's fun. I've got to give my job up. No. It's not, a lot of times, it's not either or. It's and in both. You can have both those things. You just put the right priority on those things. You get that? It's up here. You can make the same amount of money. You can have the same job. You don't have to move. Most of us, He doesn't call us to move or do. It's just the priority you put on the things of God. In their mind, they said, you know what, we're going to go fishing, but there's going to be a different priority on it. When we go fishing, we're going to look for people to tell about Jesus. I can still have the same job that I have, but when I go to work, I'm going to live for Jesus and not myself. I can still go to school and be a student, but instead of living for myself and all of that, I'm going to go to school and I'm going to live for Jesus. Your priorities changed, and that's what happened in this. They forsook all. It didn't mean they ran off and left their families. The Bible says we're not supposed to do that. But the priority of their heart and the priority of their mind changed. After that day, it was all about Jesus and not all about me. So many of us are stuck there. It's all about me. When really it needs to be all about Jesus. And if it's all about Jesus, guess what? Jesus is going to take care of me. He's done it for 57 years. Amen. And listen, I've given Him so many reasons to not take care of me. I've given Him so many reasons to give up on me. I've given so many reasons for him to walk away from me, and he has not done it yet. And his word says that he will never do it. And if he won't walk away and leave me, he will not walk away and leave you. He's worth obeying. He's worth worshiping. Stories told about a businessman was a Christian. He had his priorities, made a lot of money. But his priorities were right. He lived for Jesus. He gave, he did, he helped. He was a witness. He taught in church. And he had a son that was finishing college, got a business degree. Son was very smart also, and he went to his dad at graduation. He said, "Dad," he said, "I've got this great idea for a new business." And he said, "I just need $1,500 to get started in this business, and I think it'll be a great business." And so when graduation day came and all the people, when they graduate, they expect all these gifts. The boy was waiting for his daddy. Daddy had plenty of money. Daddy came to him and said, "Son, I got you your graduation present." And the boy said, "Well, here, Dad, let me have it." And he handed him a Bible. And he said, "Son, everything you need in this life and the life to come, you'll find in this Bible. In the pages of this Bible, you'll find." Well, guess what? The boy got mad. He said, "Daddy, I told you what I wanted for my graduation present, and I told you it's not that much you got." He said, "Son, everything you need to be successful in this life and the next, you'll find in the pages of this book." Well, the boy got mad. He went home, threw that Bible up in a bookcase somewhere, never did open it, never did look at it, nothing. Well, you know what happened? A few years went by, and the relationship of that father and son was strained. And the boy ended up making a great living. He got his business going. He was a great businessman, made a lot of money. But the relationship with his father was never exactly what it ought to be. All because the boy didn't get what he thought he ought to get. Well, you know what happened? The boy's daddy died, and the son went to the funeral, and he loved his dad, but never was quite the same. He went back home after the funeral, and he was looking through some things, and he saw that Bible that his dad had given him many years ago as a college graduation present. He took it out and he opened it up. And in there he said, "Son, everything you need in this life and the next, you'll find in the pages of these books." And there were some Bible references that the daddy had handwritten in there, different places in the Bible. And the son went and turned and looked at the first one, and it was on a lesson on how to treat people and how to treat your brothers, about Cain and Abel. And when he opened it up to the passage, guess what? $100 bill fell out. He looked, there were 15 passages of Scripture written in that Bible. And as he turned to each one of those passages of Scripture, it was how to be a good man and a good father and a good business person. But every time he would open that Bible, $100 bill would fall out, till guess what? There were $1,500. The boy just fell in tears on how he had not obeyed the simple words of his father. The father who had wisdom and loved his son. Now I'm going to tell you, don't go home and start flipping through a Bible and expect $100 bills to start falling out. Guess what? I've already tried it. It doesn't work. But let me tell you what you will get. You'll get everything you need to be successful in this life and the life to come. You'll be the right mom and dad. You'll be the right business owner. You'll be the best employee. You'll be the right student. You'll be the right teacher. You'll be the right mom. You'll be the right grandparent. Everything is about obeying God's word. But the greatest thing you ever need to obey is the call to salvation. Jesus said, "Marvel not, you must be born again. You must be saved by the grace of God. We are all sinners." And Jesus implores us and calls us to come to Him. We need to obey His word to be saved. Have you done that? That's the first step. If you've never done that, none of the rest of it will make any sense. So if you're not saved today, what a great day. Listen, God will never let you down. Jesus will never let you down. What He says, He will do. But if you're here today and you already know Jesus, starting this coming year. What do you know Jesus has already said to you? That's between you and Him. It may be something nobody else knows, but what has He spoken to your heart? You need to do this. You need to quit that. You need to forgive that person. You need to start in this service to the Lord. Whatever it is, I don't know what it is. That's between you and God. That's that personal message. But I implore you today, whatever it is, just say yes. Whether you feel like it or not. Nevertheless, Lord, at your word, I'll do what you ask me to do. And I guarantee you, according to God's word, He will not let you down. Let's pray together this morning. Every head bowed, every eye closed. I know I've gone over just a little bit. I apologize for that. But I want you to just take a moment before we begin our invitation time. Lord, what are you speaking to my heart today? Not somebody else's heart. Lord, what are you speaking to my heart today? Is it in the area of forgiveness? Is there something in your life you either need to quit doing or something in your life you need to start doing? Whatever that is, whatever it is, if you know Jesus Christ through His Word and the Holy Spirit is speaking to that to your heart, you just need to say yes. It will be for God's glory and your benefit, your blessing, every time. Father, thank you. In Jesus' name, amen. Brother's going to come this morning. If someone comes, what are we going to sing this morning, Brother Chris?
We're going to sing 465.
Let's stand together. Whatever the Lord's speaking to your heart, if you just need to come and pray, Lord, help me get this new year started right. This is a safe place today. Don't be afraid and don't be ashamed to come and bow your hearts and bow your knee to the Lord Jesus Christ as we sing this morning.